All right. So, just a quick update on where we are right now. Like I said, I am not here next week, but on Monday, there will be a session where the TAs will give you a demo of the Verilog simulation tool and how you can write a basic program in Verilog and get it simulated and check the output. Okay? And that essentially you are expected in order to use that to implement the assignment, which is to model a boot encoded multiplier, a radix 4, modified boot encoded 8x8 multiplier. Okay? The exact problem statement also we'll put up on the web, but anyway, this is what it is. It's a radix 4, 8x8 boot encoded multiplier, which obviously means it handles both positive and negative numbers. Okay? It is a combinational circuit. It takes two inputs, a multiplier and a multiplicand, and generates the product of those as a 16-bit output. Okay. So, that's the assignment. The second thing that will be happening next week is that on Friday, there will be a discussion of the tutorial question. Hopefully, all of you got the email indicating that tutorial 5 is out. Okay. There are a few questions related to SRAMs and memory in general over there, and also something related to timing. Those things will be discussed on Friday, and also by that time hopefully assignment one for sure, and hopefully also assignment 2 would have been graded and your marks would be returned to you. Okay, so I would request all of you to check on that and make sure that your assignments have been graded. If you have any problems with that, please approach the TAs and get it clarified with them. Okay. Alright, the other two classes, so Tuesday and Wednesday we will not be having class. Unless the TAs have anything, in which case they will announce it using a forum posting on Moodle. Alright, so getting back to Verilog. We were using Verilog in order to model different types of hardware. Right? And what we saw was there are a few different kinds of statements. There are some primary concepts that you need to keep in mind when you are thinking about a program or a structure of something in Verilog. Right? The first one is the so-called module. And instantiation of modules is what essentially allows us to create hardware. Right? So if I have something which I am trying to design, this is the overall chip. This is some module within that chip, this is another module within the chip, this is a third module, there are wires connecting them together. Right? This is the kind of modeling that Verilog fundamentally allows at the structural level. You can have one module, inside that there are multiple modules. You could also have nested modules so that there is a third level inside that. And go on endlessly as long as you want. Okay? The one thing it does not allow is sort of recursive definition of modules. An adder, for example, cannot be composed of other adders. Right? That's the only restriction that you have. Other than that, you can essentially use this kind of module structure in order to create one module inside another. Okay? The idea behind these modules is that they fundamentally model hardware, which means that in terms of executing the program or simulating the program, each of these modules is completely equivalent. It is not that one module happens first, then the next module and so on. At any given point in time, depending on which inputs were activated, any one of those modules could get activated and would respond. Okay? A related concept is the so-called always block. Right? So typically what we have is this. An always block also corresponds to a piece of hardware, but is typically much smaller than a complete module. Okay? Which means that usually what would happen is one module would consist of multiple always blocks. And it would also have multiple assigned statements or structural instantiation. So those are the three typical things that you would find in any module. Inside a module, there will be some assignment statements, some structural instantiations of other modules, and some always blocks. Okay? Okay? like I said, the only way to really learn this in any amount of detail is to try it out. Okay? You write a program in Verilog, simulate it, see how it behaves, modify it, and learn from that. Okay? So the TAs will be giving you a relatively simple example, essentially just how do you add numbers together in Verilog. Okay? And also a very important concept called a test bench. Right? A test bench is also a Verilog module. But it does not have any inputs or outputs. Instead, what it has is, it will have a device under test. And various other always, assign, and something called an initial block. Right? So, what exactly is the function of an initial block? You will see that when you look at the example of the test code. Right? It's essentially used to set up some part of the simulation. But it has no meaning in hardware. Right? An always block, in terms of hardware, what does it mean? It essentially says, always, whenever something happens on these inputs, do something. Okay? Now, hardware fundamentally behaves that way. A NOT gate, whenever you change its input, is going to respond. There is no start signal that it is waiting for to tell it when to start inverting the input. Okay? Whenever you give it any input change to a, let's say, a two-input NAND gate, any one of the inputs changes, immediately the output may or may not change depending on whether it is expected to change or not. Okay? There is no sort of waiting for some other signal to tell it to start. Okay. An initial block, on the other hand, is sort of saying, run this only at the beginning of the program. Right? Do this the first time that you start running this Verilog program. And if you think about it in terms of hardware, there is no physical equivalent to that. I cannot sort of build a NOT gate and say, the first time that you are created, do something. And afterwards start behaving in a different way. Right? That does not make sense. There is no physical way to do something like that for real hardware. What you can do for real hardware is to say that as soon as I switch on the power to the system, you reset all the flip-flops. That is possible. But that's different from what an initial block in Verilog is doing. An initial block is specifically trying to say, do this once at the beginning of the program. Not do it every time that the system is switched on, but do it once at the beginning of the program. So there is a difference. Okay? Alright, what I would like to do now is, I'll give some examples of always blocks in order to sort of illustrate what kind of modeling can be done using always blocks and how you can sort of use it in order to do some complex computation. Okay? So, let's say I have a code which says always at A or B, C is equal to A XOR C. Right? The caret symbol is the symbol for XOR. Okay? What does this correspond to in hardware? What do you think it corresponds to in hardware? Huh? Correct. So in terms of hardware, what will it do? What is happening? When A or B changes, what happens inside the always block? C is computed. Okay? So in other words, this is exactly telling you that this model is this. Anytime A or B changes, recompute C. Okay, that's all that this particular block is saying. It's modeling a simple XOR gate. Right? What about something a little more complicated? Now what happens? What do you think happens in such a case? What is the hardware corresponding to this? A and B, exclusive OR. C and D, AND. Okay. Now the important thing that you need to keep in mind over here is these three steps happen in sequence. Okay. That is important because supposing Z is equal to T or W happened before T is equal to AX or B, then Z will compute the wrong value. It will use some old value of T and W and get some other junk value which doesn't really correspond to anything that you want. But what we are saying is, inside the always block, the steps that you are writing over there, they happen in sequence, one after the other. Okay? An assignment like this, where you use the equal sign, is called a blocking assignment. A blocking assignment basically says you first finish this computation, then you move on to what is next. Right? So first T is equal to AX or B. What is T? It is a wire. Hopefully I have declared it as a wire somewhere, otherwise it will be implicitly declared as a 1-bit wire. So T will be computed as AX or B. W will be computed as T and B. Then Z will be computed as T or W. Okay, so those three steps are what happens. Blocking assignment means first that T computation finishes, then I move on to W is equal to C and D, then I move on to Z is equal to T or W. Okay, now it is also possible to rewrite this in another fashion in Verilog. So what have I done over here? The symbol has changed. I am using less than or equal to instead of equal to. Okay? This is what is called a non-blocking assignment. What does a non-blocking assignment do? It says, effectively, these three statements, T, W, and Z, get computed in parallel at the same time. Okay? What does that mean? It basically means that as soon as A or B or C or D, any one of them changes, right? I'll go in there and compute T based on the old values of, on the values of A and B that are there. I'll compute W based on the values of C and D that are there. I'll compute Z based on the old values, that is the existing values of T and W. not on the newly computed values of T and W. Okay? Why? Because all these three statements, T, W and Z, are getting executed in parallel with each other. So the Z is also being computed in parallel with T and W, which means it has to use the old values of T and W. Okay? So, in general, when you are trying to model combinational hardware, this is not a good idea. Okay? It still does the same thing as what the previous example did. This one also does it right. Okay? But the non-blocking assignment is a little bit more complicated. It can potentially lead to problems in what you have implemented. Okay? Hopefully you will come across examples of that by actually trying it out. But what I would suggest is you can actually go in there, run a simulator and see how this behaves under different conditions in order to find out when this could cause problems. Okay? It will not cause any wrong behavior. It will just cause probably a longer time in terms of computing what is the correct output. Okay, at least as far as this is concerned, it will not give wrong behavior. There is a specific place where non-blocking assignments are meant to be used. We will get to that later. Okay? Alright, now, supposing I write a statement like this, always at A or B, Z is equal to AX or B. Sorry, the always statement is always at A, Z is equal to AX or B. First of all, in terms of the Verilog simulator, how will this behave? Huh? Any time that A changes, I will compute Z is equal to AX or B. What happens if B alone changes, A does not change? This will not respond. Okay? Because B is not in the sensitivity list of this always block. So if B alone changes, right? What you will find is, let's say that you have a signal which looks something like this. A changes from 0 to 1, Z will immediately change from 0 to 1. Okay? But after some time, B changes from 0 to 1. What should have happened is that it should have gone low at this point. Instead, it will remain high. Z will not respond to the change in B. Okay? Now what does this mean in hardware? How will you create a hardware which has this kind of behavior? Huh? Could be. Sorry, I can't hear this. No. So putting B to ground is sort of forcing the value of B to something else. Right? What I'm saying is, can I create something which will have the correct value, which will evaluate to this value of Z in hardware? Huh? No, see, so all the things that you are saying is, if B is equal to 0, then this works correctly. If B is equal to 1, then we want A to act as sort of A complement, right? Something of that sort. The fact of the matter is, there is no hardware which will exhibit this behavior. Okay? So in other words, this is not realizable in hardware. What does it mean? It means that you cannot put together a set of gates which will show this behavior. which brings us to a very important point as far as Verilog is concerned. It is very easy to write a structure in Verilog which has no physical meaning. So do not assume that just because you wrote something in Verilog, it corresponds to hardware. It need not. Okay? Unless you write your code properly, what you write in Verilog could be completely meaningless. So you have to make sure that you write the code properly according to what it is supposed to do. Only then it has meaning as far as hardware is concerned. As far as Verilog is concerned, this is still acceptable. It satisfies the syntax. It has a proper meaning in terms of the semantics of the language. You can simulate it. It will not give you any errors in the simulation. Okay? But when you try to synthesize it, you try to convert it into hardware, the compiler that is trying to convert it will give you an error or at least a warning and say, look, this sensitivity list looks incomplete. B should be there. If B is also there in the sensitivity list, then what is it? Z is just an XOR gate. But if B is not there, right, then this does not make physical sense. Okay. So this is something to watch out for. It is entirely possible to write something in Verilog which has no meaning in hardware. Okay? Alright, next. Now, I have not told you what an if statement in Verilog is, but you can sort of understand, right? Intuitively, just like any other programming language, the if statement evaluates the condition. If it's true, then it executes whatever is there immediately after that. If you want a block of statements, then put it within begin and end. Okay? Just like in C programming, you would use the curly bracket. In Verilog, you use the words begin and end in order to show the beginning and ending of a block. Now, this looks similar to what we had earlier, right? Because A and B are missing from the sensitivity list. But what I am claiming over here is, this, what I have written over here, actually does have a meaning in hardware. What is it? Huh? Not a multiplexer. C acts like a clock. For what? It's not exactly a clock for a flip-flop, it's more like the enable signal for a latch. Right? What is it saying? Whenever C is equal to 1, right? Z must be equal to A XOR B. Okay? Actually, sorry, there is a... Sorry, there's a point that I'm missing over here. This should actually be a complete sensitive list. It has to have this, right? So now what happens is, whenever T is equal to 1, Z will take the value of A XOR B. When T is equal to 0, what happens? Whatever was the last value that Z took, that will just remain. What does this correspond to in hardware? The clock or enable signal for the last. So this is a positive latch. When C is equal to 1, the data will go through to the output. When C is equal to 0, it will just hold the last value which was there. Okay? So you did not have to write anything special to make it hold the last value. Just the fact that you omitted it means that it is automatically going to remain unchanged as far as the simulation is concerned. No, so what happens if I did not have A and B in the sensitivity list? Then only when C changes, I will look at this, which means effectively what will happen is whenever C changes from 0 to 1, I will go and look at this, right? Because when C goes from 0 to 1, only then C will be equal to 1. Effectively what I will be doing is looking only at the edges. That is when C goes from 0 to 1. Right? I will look at the points when C goes from 0 to 1 and assign Z is equal to A, X or B at that point. So it sort of looks like that will be implementing an edge-triggered flip-flop. But as far as edge-triggered flip-flops are concerned, there is a cleaner way of representing them. There is a word called POSEDGE. Right? So POSEDGE automatically means this is an event that happens at positive edge of C. Right? When C goes from 0 to 1, this particular event gets triggered. Why am I going on talking about events? Because all of Verilog is built around the idea of event-driven activity. One event triggers something else, that triggers some other behavior, that triggers something else going on in some other part of the circuit. Okay, so this particular event, what does it do? I can say, for example, Z is equal to A, X or B. I don't even have to check whether C is equal to 1. I am guaranteed that C is equal to 1 because it is a positive edge. Okay. What does this correspond to in hardware? A, X or B feeding in to C. So now you see how these simple always blocks can be used for a lot of different kinds of modeling. It can be used for basic combinational logic, it can be used for modeling a combinational logic along with a latch, or it can be used for modeling a combinational logic along with a edge-triggered flip-flop, all by changing what is there in the sensitivity list and the conditions that you use. Okay? So the always block and the idea of sensitivity list, right? Anything that happens, an event on anything in that sensitivity list will trigger an evaluation of that always block. Okay? The entire always block gets evaluated and then it has to run through again and come once more. Okay? That is essentially how Verilog models all kinds of hardware. Everything is a sequence of events happening one after the other. Okay? So all of this comes down to something called event-driven simulation. Right? What it says is, one event will trigger other events and you keep on repeating this evaluation until there are no more events to be evaluated. Okay? So for example, let's say that I have something which looks like this. Event on A will trigger an event over here. That in turn will trigger an event over here. But over here, there are no more events after this. Okay? Now, the next thing that you can use, so this was interesting, right? The always at POSIX C essentially allows us to model sequential hardware, because now we are able to create a block which acts like some kind of a flip-flop or a register, right? What you can do with that is, one, so this actually helps us to illustrate the idea of blocking versus non-blocking statement slightly better, right? I'll give you two pieces of code and I want you to say what is the difference between the two. What does the code on the left do? Q3 will become equal to D, right? Why is that? Because as soon as the POSIX clock happens, so there is something over here. There is a clock. When the POSIX clock happens, Q1 will take the value of D. Immediately after that, Q2 will take the value of Q1. And Q3 will take the value of Q2, which means Q3 will take the value of D. Okay, so effectively it is also, I have over here D, Q1, Q2 and Q3. Sorry, Q1 and Q2 on the input. Q3 takes this value and puts there on the output. Okay, what does the code on the right hand side do? Now, remember what non-blocking statements do? All those three assignments happen in parallel. Q1 equal to D, Q2 equal to Q1, Q3 equal to Q2. All three of them happen at the same time. Okay? What do I mean by same time? As and when Q1 is getting the value of D, Q2 gets the old value of Q1. And Q3 gets the old value of Q2. There is no order in which these are evaluated. It doesn't matter. The language, the meaning of the language itself says that the way that you have to interpret this is that all of them happen together. Okay? In terms of hardware, what does this look like? This is a shift register. Three registers, one after the other. This is D, this is Q1, Q2, Q3. Okay? So what we have over here is that the non-blocking assignment was a nice way of indicating that all the events which happen at the clock edge, which are all supposed to happen in parallel with each other, they should all happen at the same time. Okay? So the non-blocking assignment are good for sequential modeling. What you are trying to do over here, you want to model a shift register of 3 steps, it does exactly the job that you want. Okay? Now the interesting thing is it doesn't matter in which order you wrote this. So for example, supposing I modified the thing before to say Q3 equal to Q2, Q2 equal to Q1, Q1 equal to D. Right? Now, the left hand side is actually going to behave like a shift register. Because Q3 gets the old value of Q2, Q2 gets the old value of Q1, and then Q1 gets updated to D. This is how you would write it, for example, if you are writing it in a C program. You need to make sure that the order is correct. Right? So this would correspond to a proper shift register. So just changing the order of those statements made such a big difference to how it gets interpreted. Right? But as far as non-blocking assignment is concerned, it didn't matter. It would have been exactly the same either way. Okay? So for the non-blocking assignment, both ways, the order in which the statements happen inside the always block does not really matter. Okay? Alright, now with all of this in mind, I'm just going to briefly touch upon the assignment question, which is, how do I model radix 4 8x8 boot encoded multiplier? Okay. So the first thing, what is it that we have over there? There are two inputs. A is the multiplier or the, yeah, the multiplier. B is the multiplicand. C is the output. This is 8 bit. This is also 8 bit. This is 16 bit. And all in 2's complement format. Okay? Now, first things first, how should you go about thinking of a program like this? Don't think of how you would write a C program for implementing this. Instead, think about, supposing you were asked to implement it on a breadboard, what are the components that you would need? How would you connect them together? That is always the better way of sort of deciding on how to implement something in Verilog. Because you have to keep in mind that finally you want to get a piece of hardware out. Right? You are not just trying to write a program which runs in a simulation, you want to get a piece of hardware that actually works as hardware. Okay? So, what you think of for this is, you are trying to design this box. Now, how does a boot encoded multiplier work? It essentially says, I will take the value A group it into 3 at a time and use this to generate partial product, right? Then add. But you have to make sure that you shift the partial products appropriately so that they align up correctly when you are trying to add them. Okay? So now the problem of designing the multiplier has been replaced by how do I generate partial product. Okay? And if you think about that, it essentially becomes what are the inputs for a partial product. It essentially says I have to take the 8 bit input D, 3 bit input of AI plus 1, AI minus 1, and give a output. Okay. The output will also actually be 8 bits, will actually be 9 bits because you also have a partial product like 2A and so on, or rather 2B. But instead what we are going to do is straight away say that look, the partial product finally, yeah, the partial product, I mean you are finally going to need a 16 bit partial product. So why don't you straight away generate a 16 bit partial product so that they can just be aligned properly and added as required. Okay, so we'll make this a 16 bit partial product. Right? Now, how does that partial product computation work? You remember we discussed that there was a table that you create. So on, right? All of these entries were there. Please go back, look up the reference for a modified boot encoded multiplier, right? And find out exactly what are the partial products that need to get implemented. Now what have you done? You have essentially taken the problem of creating a partial product and converted it into a lookup table problem. I need to look up some value based on the three values of A that I have, three bits of A. Look up from somewhere else and generate a partial product which is 16 bits wide. Okay? What kind of hardware does that look like? Based on the three inputs of A, I need to generate something else. What's the simplest piece of hardware you can think of which will do that? Okay, the simplest that I can think of is a multiplexer. Okay? Three bits from A. What are the inputs? 0, B, B, 2B, and so on. So that only one of them comes through to the output. Okay. So effectively what does your overall hardware look like? At this point, I now have 4 partial product generators, 3 bit select, from A. Okay, so this will be A1, A0, A-1, A3, A2, A1, A5, A4, A3, A7, A6, A5. Sixteen bit partial products come as the output. Okay. Now I need to shift them and add. The first one does not need to be shifted because it is already in the correct weightage. This is what your hardware should look like. You should be able to generate partial products, do the shifting and the addition, and generate the final output. Are there any flip flops over here? Do you need any flip flops in this design? What about this shift? Does it require flip flops? How many things yes? How many things no? Okay, why not? Why do you not need any flip flop? You can just hardwire it, right? What is a shift over here actually? It is taking a partial product and saying I need to permanently shift this by 2 before adding. I don't need to go through 2 clock cycles to shift it. I have an adder. It is taking 2 16-bit values. One of them I feed in without shifting. The other one I feed in after shifting left by 2. What does shifting left by 2 mean? I take the bottom 14 bits, put 2 zeros after that and feed that into it. That's all. So this kind of shifting does not require flip-flop. Okay? It can be done directly by means of adjusting the wire location. Okay? So this will be a fully combinational circuit which has a structure like this. It essentially consists of these partial products plus whatever is required for shifting plus an addition. Okay. Please go look up exactly how a boot encoded multiplier works, how these partial products would be generated, how you would implement all of this in Verilog, how do you, for example, write a multiplexer in Verilog, right? And how do you connect everything together to give you your final correct result. The assignment is to write all of that and to implement it in such a way that it can be put into a test bench which will test it against different values and tell you whether the result is correct or not. Okay? So the TAs will give you a test bench. The test bench will automatically, you can just put your Verilog code for the boot multiplier into the test bench, try it out for a few different samples, and it will tell you whether or not it passed. How does it do that? Because in the test bench, I know what the expected outputs are. I can directly say if this output from this multiplier does not match with the expected output, there's something wrong with your implementation. Okay? So that's the assignment, and that's also the end of today's class. We will meet again on November 9th. Meanwhile, of course, there are classes next week. Monday there will be an introduction to Verilog, and on Friday there will be another session about the assignments and tutorials.